you're taught as a young kid to sort of put on these layers of armour to get out there and get into the fray. One of my grandfather's old saying, he sort of said, it's better to wake up in an ambulance than duck out of a contest.
Oh, you can hear the sound. Crunch! It reverberated around Australia, that one.
You're so worried in professional sport, you're so worried about keeping your position in the team and the pressure of making the finals, the top eight.
I obviously do think about it every now and then, and I hope that I don't have long-term effects when I do finish.
Something that's really frustrating and quite sad, I guess. I can't actually go back and or go out and, you know, muck around with my mates and play footy and play with, you know, play for a club that I love. I was at a point in time where I was hoping that my career was starting to take off.
Justin Clark played in the AFL for 5 years. At 22, he was looking like a promising defender.
It was just like any other normal day of pre-season. Went out for a marking contest, slight little nudge from behind, and there was a roving player that was coming the opposite direction. His knee collected my head and I was out for about half a minute. Concussion symptoms of headaches and inability of being able to exercise, mood swings. It all became much, much more difficult to go about my day-to-day life.
It only took one serious concussion for three separate neurologists to tell Justin he'd be mad to keep playing.
After that neuropsych appointment, I remember sitting in the car and I was inconsolable. It was very much, if you were my son, there was no chance that I'd be letting you play football again.
Since his career-ending concussion, Justin Clark has been working with the Queensland Brain Institute at the University of Queensland to better understand the effects of head knocks in sport.
Since concussion is a mild injury, it affects the brain in a specific way. The extent of damage we can't assess and we can't diagnose because we can't see the effects. And I think that's why most people sort of ignore it.
Dr. Fatima Nasrallah is a neuroscientist with UQ's Queensland Brain Institute and is investigating the long-term effects concussion has on Aussie athletes. She believes concussion in sport is a real issue that's not properly understood.
You know, we need to make people aware that these symptoms actually do reflect a damage in the brain, and you need to be cautious of how you react to that damage.
And Jude Bolton is as tough a footballer as I've seen.
Well, I was drafted in 1999, so, I mean, the attitudes then were that, you know, it's almost a bit of a joke. It's sort of, we used to call guys candles if you, you know, got knocked out one time. Wouldn't even worry about the assessment during the week or anything like that. It's just how you're feeling, get ready to go the next week.
Jude Bolton is no stranger to a concussion or two, playing 325 games for the Sydney Swans. Those attitudes of the past, he says, need to change.
It wasn't until my grandfather came back, I think it was a year or so later, I had two concussions in a game, and he just sort of said, you don't want to be a dribbling mess when you're an old man. And I look back now and I feel I was pretty foolish to get back out on the field.
Injury and playing with injury is a badge of honour, without a doubt.
David Croft played for Queensland and Australia in rugby union. He doesn't want to see the confrontational nature of the game disappear, but says the glorification of hits is part of the problem.
The fact that your brain gets bruised or injured and you can still run around is a scary thing. Brain injury is no different to a cork thigh or a busted knee. You know, it should be treated the same.
Professor Mike O'Sullivan is a neurologist at UQ's Queensland Brain Institute. He says the long-term effects of head knocks aren't necessarily just a result of serious concussions.
If you think about smoking, you know, it's the total exposure in terms of number of cigarettes or amount of tobacco in a whole lifetime that counts. I think with head injuries, it's probably the cumulative energy absorbed by the brain in collisions that count.
But this damage isn't always easy to detect. In fact, concussions may not have any obvious symptoms. And just because symptoms disappear or didn't show up in the first place, it doesn't mean an athlete is safe to return to play.
And so you might get symptoms for a week and they're gone, but the actual damage in the brain lasts for weeks and weeks. Because we know that there is a vulnerable window where your brain is trying to recover from that mild injury. If you get even the slightest concussion again, that might linger the symptoms and also linger the brain damage.
Amanda Faruja is captain of AFLW Giants and admits these knocks are just part of the game.
Yeah, it's pretty scary because it happens so quickly and a lot of the times you don't know that it's coming. It's quite a shock. Often you feel that whole really quick movement of your neck.
While she prides herself on having courage over the ball, she's also a teacher and wants a life after footy, so she takes these knocks seriously.
I'm the one that has to live with my brain for the rest of my life. Football won't pay the bills forever, but you know, my career in teaching will, and I need my brain for that.
Although Amanda's attitude is a reflection of the changing culture in Aussie sport, concussion is an invisible injury that remains under-researched and underfunded. For some, like NRL legend Martin Lang, the uncertainty of concussion's long-term effects are enough to make them wish they never played.
Look, if I had my time again, I wouldn't do it, but I don't regret it, if that makes any sense. In my case, I didn't start thinking as clearly about things until I was sort of well retired. Everybody knows I wasn't blessed with a lot of natural ability, and that's why I had to play like I did. I played that physical type game where I did have to put my body on the line. If I didn't play like that, I probably wouldn't have played in the NRL. So, you know, was it a good decision or not? Time will only tell. I think knowledge is power. So I think the more we find out about something, the safer a game will be.
Although that knowledge, rugby Charlotte's Caslick believes, isn't really being imparted to athletes.
I think if I'd never experienced one before, I probably would have no idea about how severe and serious they can be. So I think it would be nice if we did get educated a little bit more around it. We obviously do a lot of anti-doping and gambling and all of those things included in the sport, but not so much concussion at this stage.
While Professor Mike O'Sullivan believes the codes are doing well based on the information they have, he says it's not driven by enough science.
To really sort the problem out, we need to see much greater collaboration across larger studies, across codes and in large groups of people. You know, we don't want to see sports die because of worries about what it's doing to the brain, which may be misplaced. And I think there is a huge onus on the research community to work constructively with sport.
I think to be able to understand, we need to perform the research. And to be able to perform the research, we need people to be aware that this is a problem. It is solvable if we understand more about it.
Justin Clark is now studying aeronautical engineering at the University of Queensland. Although he's living with a different version of normal, he doesn't blame footy.
It's something that gives so much to you as a person, or improves your life quality from a health aspect, from a mental health aspect. It's just a fantastic part of society, but it's just knowing that there are risks and there needs to be mitigation controls put in place to make sure that we're not putting ourselves at undue risk.